He serves as an advisor and a board member to IBM Watson, University of Texas Department of Computer Science, and ClearCube Technology. 2 years ago, Amir was named Austin's Top Technology Entrepreneur of the Year. Please welcome the CEO of SparkCognition, Amir Husain.
Thank you for that very generous introduction. You know, my topic today is going to be artificial intelligence, and let's see if I can figure out the clicker here based on my human intelligence. Okay, there we go. So the topic that I wanted to touch today was artificial intelligence and the future of work. When you think about artificial intelligence, there are really two big topics that come up, right? There's two big questions that people have at sort of an existential level. And these are well captured by these worthies who you may have seen many times in the press. Most recently, President Putin had made a statement that he who controls AI controls the world. This Tuesday, so 3 days ago, I was briefing the Deputy Secretary General of NATO in Brussels, and I'll tell you that the concern in NATO as well as at the DoD is very real. These are not hypothetical statements that are being given in Russian newspapers that nobody's paying attention to. This is absolutely real. So now, why is this happening? Well, there's two big genres of existential threats that folks talk about. Elon Musk says, you know what, all of this witchcraft, we're really summoning the demon. His words, not mine. Vladimir Putin says, well, great, maybe we can control the demon and rule the world. And we'll see what happens. But again, the two categories, AI will take away all our jobs and AI will kill us, you know, the Terminator scenario. These are the two big existential issues. So it's wonderful to be in this profession. When I've spoken at large conferences, there are people outside with banners, no to the robots, and there's all sorts of protests. And by the way, I understand that. It's a time of great concern in this country that comes not just because of the technological developments, but also because of all of the social flux that we're seeing around ourselves. So these are issues that have to be addressed. Now, let me tie this back to something that I've been talking about for a while. This is a quote actually from Marc Andreessen, the founder of Netscape. A few years ago, he said, look, software is eating the world. Well, what does that mean? Does it mean Pac-Man is on the loose and you know, is consuming the world? Actually, what it means is this, that the image on the left is a traditional combustion engine, the kind of thing that you have in your car. And now there you can see, for example, depending on its age, you can see a carburetor, you can see an EFI perhaps, you can see valves and pistons, and you can see a timing belt, and you can see all these various different things. On the right-hand side, you see an electric motor. All of the functionality of the asset on the left is present in the asset on the right. But where did all the parts go? Because the parts were there for a reason. After all, a very smart individual designed this engine, so everything served its purpose. Well, all of that functionality has been subsumed in software. On the right, you still have the ability to control how energy flows into the motor and how speed is controlled and so on, but it's no longer an EFI. It's no longer the physical fuel being injected and in what mix that allows that to happen. It's all software. Software is physically eating the world by diminishing the amount of physical goods that go into building the products that we ship today. It's real and it's happening. My corollary to this is that AI is now eating software, okay? So on the left, you see the traditional view, you know, the diligent programmer working through the night in the dungeon, just going at it and producing all this beautiful code. That code is mostly what we call if-then-else code. The programmer is really thinking about everything that might happen, and he or she is imagining all the consequences of what they're building. And then in the real world, if they encounter a situation that they haven't anticipated, problem. On the right-hand side, you see some work that's being done in Europe. Professor Guyton-Beek et al. Have invested in this. And this is a genetic algorithm. The genetic algorithm is not explicitly designed to control anything. It's just designed to optimize certain behaviors. It doesn't know how it'll optimize them. It doesn't know the if then else of how to make one of these creatures walk. But the same algorithm is controlling a biped and an ostrich-like monstrosity. And you'll see soon giraffes that seem to tumble over but then learn how to stand up again. And a gorilla-like creature that can have boxes thrown at it, and it can sustain quite a lot of abuse. These are all capabilities that would, in the old scheme of things, require many programmers to sit down, understand physics. Well, now a genetic algorithm is doing all of this for you. That's just one example. We use genetic algorithms for a whole bunch of things. We've used genetic algorithms to fly aircraft more reliably than the best pilots. It's pretty amazing. Okay, so this is how AI now is eating software. So we talked about the software profession, and a couple of years ago, we all went off on this fantasy of everybody should code for different reasons. Don't tell kids that they need to code because they will get a good job. Some of them might. Tell kids that they need to code because without this, they have no understanding of the framework of computer science and the world more and more, and as more and more of the secrets of the universe are revealed, it turns out that the fundamental scaffolding of computer science is one of the best lenses through which to understand our reality. That's why they need to program, not just because they'll get a better job. So, coming back to jobs. I just took a look at the Texas jobs and the top 10 jobs. By the way, the distribution is actually quite different to the overall distribution across jobs in the United States. In fact, the number of vehicle operators, drivers, in Texas is lower as a percentage than elsewhere. But let's just take a look at a few of them, right? We don't need to be very specific on the numbers, but you know, there's about 2 million office assistants, and there's 1.2 million people in sales and food prep and transportation and moving. Okay, so now we get a and there's healthcare and production and manufacturing. I'm just a few call-outs, right? Because I'll talk about how there might be impact in these areas and what that impact might be. Now, on the right-hand side, that chart came from a study. And what that chart says is that given different types of jobs and different types of skills, how soon could that skill or that job be completely carried out by artificial intelligence? And that slider is a confidence of estimates. That's the median estimate, the little blue doohickey in the middle of the slider. That's the median estimate. So you see, for example, truck driver, and I'm going to try and not fall over. Truck driver is somewhere around 25 years or something like that. You know what? That's pessimistic in my view. If you've looked at Tesla's announcements about the Tesla Semi, if you've looked at Peterbilt and what they're doing, could be 10 years. So a lot of these are pessimistic. Some of these are optimistic. But here's the point that most people seem to miss. This gets into sort of a humans versus machines binary, an unpleasant sort of a contest. And the reality is that we are heading into an economy where, given the rate at which automation is creating capacity, we might be looking at a world that has to sustain 20%, 25% unemployment. And there are these, in my view, and I'll take this view, there are these fictions that, you don't worry about all of this. I mean, of course there'll be new jobs. We just don't know what they are, but of course there'll be new jobs. Here's the problem with that. The problem with that is that mankind basically has only done two meaningful things in the last 2 million years. One meaningful thing has been the replication of muscle, which happened in the late 1700s. And the other meaningful thing we are on the cusp of, we're trying very hard to get there, which is the replication of the mental muscle, the replication of cognitive capability. Now, it doesn't matter whether we get there in 10, 20, 30, 50, 70 years for two reasons. One, the broad consensus is eventually we will get there. 100 years is nothing in the history of man. Two, that along the way, there will be incremental additions in capability, what we call artificial narrow intelligence, that will significantly impact entire vertical areas of work. And that brings me back to my earlier point, what about an economy with 25, 35, 43% unemployment? So the reason why I don't care for the platitudes that I hear very often, which is that, oh, you know, don't worry, look the other way, it'll be fine. You know, it's happened before. No, it's not happened before. The quantum of what we're trying to do now has not happened before. So what needs to be done now is that you need to address the problem. And this problem is partially a technology problem, but partially a policy problem. Our misfortune in this country, being the shining city on the hill for decades, our misfortune in this country is that when the UAE announces their AI minister 3 days ago, and a few months ago I met with Mohammed bin Zayed at his palace, he is fully committed to investing what needs to be invested to make AI work out of the UAE. When China announces their 2030 strategy for artificial intelligence, the amount of money they're spending on it, we simply can't match. We simply don't have the dollars to invest in that area. So we have some relative strengths. We've got to be able to figure out who's putting that policy together. What are our national priorities? In the short window of time that we have to make a difference in this space, what in the world are we doing? We're certainly not putting together an AI policy. So that's obviously something that we've taken up as a challenge also, in DC, both with the military and the government, Senate Armed Services Committee, wherever anybody will open the door and let us in, we just run in and make our case. Because at the end of the day, I think that's a huge service. We need to engage the nation in this conversation, and that's not happening, okay? So, the other thing I'll tell you is that, look, I just picked four categories because I only had 12 minutes of time, which hopefully I still have two. Yes? Okay. Look, here's what's happening, right? AI-based assistants, we talked about things like Siri and Cortana and natural language processing, and these things will become incrementally smarter, and Alexa, and an open skill set to where you can do more things over time. Of course, that'll happen. But now that's also being merged with robotics. There are some robotic capabilities, some mobility. Slowly over time, these are incremental things. They don't need like a quantum breakthrough. Incremental capabilities will get these far along. Here in Austin, I'm so proud, we have a robotics startup on the lower left, a company called MakerArm that's doing cognitive manufacturing. You take this robot, you put it on a desk, it takes up to 18 different tool heads. It'll laser, it'll cut, it'll mill, it'll pick and place, it'll solder, it'll do basically the work of a factory. And at a cost point that allows us to bring some of these capabilities back to the US. You need one person and eight of these things running on a table, collaborating with each other to actually build something. That's never happened before at that scale. AI and robotics. So places like Japan, there's people that are bedridden. They've got an inverted demographic pyramid. What do they do? They need to go to the restroom. What do they do? Do they have 24/7 support with a nurse there constantly? They can't do that. Not just because of the expense, but because they don't have the people. So robotics will have to solve this problem. It will have to solve this problem. When that problem is solved, what are the implications of it? Will it stay contained in Japan? Obviously not. Look at all the other inverted demographic countries. Our partners, Boeing, are investing just in the last week. They've made two acquisitions in autonomous transportation. Autonomous transportation is not just about the self-driving car. Autonomous transportation is about submarines that guide themselves and go 8 times around the world with no one inside. And it's about flying things in the air that are carrying people and goods. It's a completely different world. These are business models that haven't yet even been fully thought through. But their impact on the jobs that I was showing you earlier will be profound. When you replicate the human muscle, what you saw was that most labor that required man to yield human muscle as the primary input to that economic activity man's role in that diminished. You have the farming statistics, the 100 years ago, and we're across the board. If we come close to replicating, not creating a sentient being and not lore or data or, you know, actually that is the plan. Hopefully we'll get there. But even if we don't get there, if we get enough of that done, then you have a situation where what else do you have to add value to? Emotions. So healthcare will still be great. But not healthcare research, because medicine research and discovery can be done better with genetic algorithms probably, right? So we have to be open to a world that is coming soon where the social contracts we have in place will no longer support this age-old assumption that, you know, you wake up in the morning and you wear those jeans and you go, you know, put some barbed wire around the open area in Texas and you go grab some cattle and you're your own rancher and then three generations later you're a billionaire. Those opportunities won't be around. And we cannot now look down upon people that a 57-year-old truck driver who spent his entire life driving super safely and then one day is told, you know what, that Tesla semi is going to replace you, but we'd like to re-educate you. Why don't you, at the age of 57, go back to UT Austin and learn bioengineering? How exciting is that? Not going to happen. It's human nature. It's mental plasticity, right? Not going to happen. So this all falls on policymakers and government folks. And that, I believe, is a discussion that isn't happening. And I hope with this here, and all the other efforts that we're involved in, that we can get into that. So thank you very much.